Joining me now is Sherrod Brown, the Democratic senator from Ohio, where culture may have played a bigger role than anything else in moving the state from Barack Obama to Donald Trump. Senator Brown, welcome back to the show, sir.
Good to be back. Thanks, Chuck.
Let me start with you rhetorically answering a question that John Kasich, your governor, put out there. He essentially was saying the Democrats have a golden opportunity and he doesn't know what they stand for beyond being anti-Trump, which he didn't realize that is how we were setting up this segment. Is that a fair criticism that both us in the media and Republicans are making right now?
Not entirely, but I'll start with this. I applaud my governor, Republican. I'm a Democrat. I applaud him for standing with us to fight back against the Republican plan to take health insurance away from, in my state, 900,000, around the country, 22 million. What was interesting about that, Chuck, is that a bunch of members of Congress in both houses who get insurance paid for by taxpayers were willing to take it away from millions and millions of Americans. And I thank Governor Kasich for standing on that. That's what Democrats stand for. But fundamentally, this is, you win elections by contrast. And we've seen a president of the United States who probably won Ohio because most Ohioans haven't had a raise in the last 20 years. And they've seen wages go up, they've seen profits go up, they've seen executive compensation go up, they've seen their wages flat. And this president in the White House the last 7 months has done nothing for workers. I have, and I fought for workers. I've done it in the past, I'm doing it now. I'll continue to do it. That's what Democrats stand for. That's how you win Ohio.
Yeah, but let me point out something. This is the David Betras, he was the chair of the Democratic Party in Mahoning County, Ohio. And he wrote this in a memo right after the election. He said, look, I'm as progressive as anybody, okay? But people in the heartland thought the Democratic Party cared more about where someone else went to the restroom than whether they had a good paying job. I know what you said about what you've done in Ohio, but speak as the Democratic Party as a whole. Do you understand why some people in the heartland saw that?
Well, I understand what the press coverage is of all of this, and I understand the Democrats will always stand up to hate speech, whether it's coming from the president or whether it's coming from the Klan or the Nazis, or the anti-Semites and the racists in Virginia and the 35 organizations identified in Ohio that are hate groups. I understand Democrats always stand up for that because we are the party of justice. Connie and I last night were at a dinner with the Human Rights Campaign talking about the importance of human rights. But I also know that people in my state, they support my position on trade. I oppose NAFTA, one of the first votes I ever cast. I've stood up to presidents of both parties against bad trade agreements. When President Obama, his last couple of years in office, the Secretary of Labor came out with an overtime rule. 130,000 people in my state got a raise from that. This president, the White House looks like an executive retreat for Goldman Sachs now. And the president surrounds himself with that. They're trying to weaken this overtime rule. I mean, it really is whose side you stand on. I stand with David Betras in Mahoning Valley. I understand exactly what he said. And he's right about Democrats fighting for workers. I've always done that. As you know, Chuck, I wrote a book about trade. I understand what we need to do for a different trade policy to raise wages to help those workers. In the end, it's whose side are you on? This president is on the side of Wall Street and big oil and the drug companies.
All right.
My career has not been, and you understand that, and you know that.
Well,
let
me ask you though about trade. This president keeps threatening to cancel NAFTA. I assume that's might be welcome news to your ears. If that's what he does, you're going to support this president in doing that?
I first do a shout out to U.S. Trade Rep Lighthizer from my wife's hometown of Ashtabula, Ohio. He is the best appointee in the Trump administration. I talk to him at least every 2 weeks. We are talking about NAFTA renegotiation, how we do it. We start off by Buy America, the preconditions for negotiations, starting with Buy America provisions, with anti-outsourcing provisions. I want workers' voices at the table. I don't want these trade agreements written by corporate interests, then using these trade agreements to shut down production in Newark and Toledo, Ohio, and Mansfield, and move overseas and sell those products back into the United States. That's what a trade policy is about. The president's problem problem is he's surrounded in the White House with a bunch of people that like those trade agreements. And so Representative Lighthizer, the Ambassador Lighthizer, has to figure out, how do you get this White House to support him on wanting to renegotiate NAFTA and put workers first? That's the problem we face. That's what I fight for in the Finance Committee.
But you
that's
will
what I
work fought, with this president.
In the Senate.
If he sticks by this, you will continue to work with him on this.
So 2 days after the election, right, as disheartened as I was, and my friends were, and so many of us in Ohio were, I called the president's head of his transition and offered to help him renegotiate NAFTA, offered to help him enforce trade rules, mm-hmm, especially for steel, talked to him about the Trans-Pacific Partnership. So I've been there all along. I sat with Trade Representative Lighthizer, with Senator Portman, my Republican colleague, with Senator Dole, who was his boss, sat with him in the Finance Committee to introduce him to my colleagues. I work with this president. When he's right on trade, it's mixed. I don't know if he's going to be right on trade, because he's not really done anything on it yet except make speeches.
And let me ask finally about this idea. Is the Democratic Party a big tent party? Are you comfortable? You ran, for instance, on tougher border security in 2006. You voted for the Secure Fence Act. In these days, can you be a Democrat in good standing and have that take a tougher line on immigration, or will the base of the Democratic Party throw you out?
No, the base of the Democratic Party's not throwing me out. I fight for all the things that the values that this country stood for decades. I think the border wall is ludicrous. I stand for a strong immigration policy because I want to see us bipartisanly do what we tried to do a few years ago, even with President Bush and later with President Obama. I want to work with Senator Rubio in Florida. I want to work with others. I listened to what Governor Kasich said. It's terrible when we take people, when we are taking immigrants who have been here 10 or 15 years, mm-hmm, in working hard, paying their taxes, active in their church, acting in the communities, parents, and we throw them out of this country. Governor Kasich's dead right on that. We have no business doing that. That inhumane policy coming from administration is just part and parcel of what he's been for the last 7 months.
But very quickly, what's the difference between you supporting a fence and the president's call
there was money for security, and they had some language in there, as many people in both parties voted for, but not to spend tens of billions of dollars to build a wall. I've never supported that. I've spoken out against that from the day that Canada Trump proposed it. And you know that, Chuck.
All right, Senator Brown, I'm going to leave it there. Thanks for coming on this morning. I appreciate it.
Of course.
And sharing your views. All right.